Hi, artists. Hi, I'm Ms. Bollinger. I'm the art teacher at Oaks Elementary School. Today, we are going to learn about tessellations. A tessellation is a pattern made of one or more shapes that repeat in a pattern. But this pattern is pretty unique because there aren't any gaps and the shapes do not overlap. They fit together an infinite number of times, over and over, much like puzzle pieces. Have you ever seen a tessellation? You probably have, but maybe didn't know that that's what you were looking at. Tessellations can be found in nature. Let's take a look at this turtle shell. Let's look at the shapes and how they're, if we look closely, they're all the same. And they touch edge to edge and they fit together like a puzzle. Now this is the closest I would ever want to get to a snake. This is a photo of a snake's scales, but let's take a close look at these scales. These scales are also identical in shape and they fit together edge to edge perfectly and repeat in a pattern. You could even have a very simple example of a tessellation in your home, maybe even on one of the floors in your house. It could be as simple as something like these square tiles. If we observe them closely, yes, they fit together edge to edge without any gaps or overlapping, and they go on and on this way for as many times as we want them to. So these squares are a very basic example of tessellations. Tessellations can be found in nature in so many ways. Let's look at this pineapple. Well, this particular pineapple is alone at the beach, looking out over the ocean, alone. Maybe this pineapple is thinking about how its skin is actually a tessellation. Let's zoom in a bit closer and take a better look. Here is an artist who's known around the world for his realistic drawings and artwork that involves tessellations. His name is M.C. Escher. M.C. Escher studied architecture and art, and he became very interested in these interlocking shape designs when he was traveling for school and really admired the decorative, colorful, and very complicated patterns that he saw in the tile floors of some of the more interesting places that he had visited. M.C. Escher was interested in nature themes for his artwork. These are some of his tessellation pieces that he's made. While he was alive, he made over 2,000 drawings and over, well, about 448 or so printing plates featuring tessellations and some of his other drawings. Let's look at these birds that he's made. At first, the white bird shapes may stand out a bit more than the others. These could attract the eye, much like positive spaces we learned about in a previous lesson. But if we were to look at the remaining spaces, the darker birds in the, that also fill this artwork equally, we see that both the positive and negative are identical, that these are all the same exact shape. Let's also take a look at his blue and white fish artwork here. Again, these shapes are all identical. These are tessellations. Many of M.C. Escher's artworks involve lizards. If we take a look at this one, we can see that he's taken on a third color in the artwork, as we see that he's repeating this pattern involving lizards that seem to be rotating with three colors. And he also has made many of these in this series of lizards in just black and white. So I hope you're interested in making one of these tessellating shapes, because now we are going to make our own And although M.C. Escher's artwork appears very complicated, I'm going to show you today how you can make your own shape that tessellates. And you will too have a design that looks as if it was much more difficult to make than it actually is. You will need something thick or heavy, like a cardstock type paper. If what you have is computer paper, that is okay. But just be aware that you'll be tracing around the shape that we make today. So you'll need to just hold those edges down a bit better. An index card works really well if you can find one of those at home. You'll also need something to draw with. It could be anything. You'll also need a pair of scissors, and you'll also need some tape. For later, you will need a larger sheet of paper to practice tracing your tessellating tile shape onto, so you can see how it works. To start my tessellation tile, first I need to turn whatever kind of cardstock I have into as close to a perfect square as I can. So for us to do that together today, I'm going to take my rectangle shape that this currently is. I'm going to take one of its corners and attempt to fold it down like that. It's a little awkward at this angle, but I'm trying to show you. I want to line up these two edges exactly together. I'm going to crease that down like that. Does everyone see that? So what I've done is I have folded this side to this, like just like so. Okay, I brought one corner down and I'm left with that. I'm going to then take my pen, just trace it across the bottom. And when I open it, when I lift that flap, I should see what looks like a square in whatever portion of the paper that I have left. Your tile shouldn't be too big, or too small. So right around this size, which I think my starting square will be right around 3 inches. It's about perfect. Next, you will need your scissors, and you will want to carefully cut along that line, leaving you with your square. And then I like to take the two corners. Do you see how there's this crease in my paper from the first fold that I did? I like to take these two corners and bring them together. And this will give me really nice implied X shape through my square. This is going to be very helpful as I work along all four of these edges. If your paper is the same on both sides, like for example, if you had white on both sides, you would need to put marks on the opposite side. My paper happens to have these lines because it was an index card. But just to make sure I'm really aware that there's one side that's different than the other, I am going to just mark it up. You're not drawing on it. It's not meant to look, you know, pretty or anything, but you just want to mark it up so that you can fully differentiate one side from the other side. This will be very useful later. Now we're going to choose our first edge that we want to work along. It could be any one of these four sides. And just inside the folded edges here, I'm going to make a very dark mark and a very dark mark. Now these are on the same edge, the same side of the square. And they're just in a little bit from the corners. For the shapes to work, this mark can't be on a different side. They should be sharing the same side for this first shape. Once you put a dot there and a dot there, then you can just invent a shape. You can try out some of the different kinds of lines that we learned about a few weeks ago. And you just want to connect those two dots with a line. Make sure that your line is nice and heavy and easy to see, because you will be cutting it out very soon. Now we're going to cut this shape out. As you cut, be really careful. Remember to turn your paper, aim your scissor blades away from you. Try your best. to stay on this line, to cut out your shape. If you miss and your scissors go off track, just keep going from where you are. If you go back and trim out little bits and pieces, the shape we remove may not fit back exactly into the original space. So this is the square that I've removed my shape from. And this is the piece that I have cut out. So what we want are two pieces that would fit together exactly perfectly like this, like a puzzle. Now we are going to choose which side of this square we're going to re-add this shape that we just subtracted from it. So as you see, it fits perfectly right there. Now, if I put this on any one of these three remaining edges, this will become a really neat tessellation tile. And it will work as long as the two sides that are the same are facing the same direction. Meaning that if I taped it on this way with my shaded side up against the lighter face of my square, it won't fit. It doesn't fit in that direction. So it's very important that from whichever side you're working from, that they are the same. So right here, I'm going to take it, and I'm feeling like right along that edge could be really nice. I think I want to tape it there. It's important that I tape it edge to edge, that I don't overlap it. I shouldn't overlap it. I also can't have it extend beyond the corner. It has to perfectly sit somewhere within the edge of that square. So it looks like this, and it looks like this. So these are its current two sides. Now I can pick either this edge or this edge and remove another shape. This is going to make it a really interesting tessellation. So again, I could take a look at these two corners. I can make a mark there on the inside that edge. And a mark there inside that edge and make up a shape. That shape could do about anything I want. I'm going to make it nice and dark for you to see better from where you are. And there you go. So I've just drawn a wiggly line that is using this edge of the square. I haven't done anything to this side yet. And now I have my scissors again. So I'm going to very carefully cut along this wavy line to remove this second shape from this other edge of my square, following all the same ideas as I did with the first one. So now I have this piece and I have this piece. I want to keep my eyes on which side looks different because that's not going to fit. I want to make sure that however I tape it to the square again, that these sides are facing the same way. Thinking I like it like that, I could use any part of this square as long as this piece does not go beyond this edge. I'm going to tape it together. I'm going to get a little bit of my tape. And make sure that it's edge to edge, that nothing is overlapping, that I'm not going past my corners, that it's sitting someplace entirely within that line there. I'm going to tape it down just like that. So my tile looks like this on this side, and it looks like this on this side. Now that you have finished your tessellation tile, now's the fun part. You'll just need a piece of paper. It doesn't have to be any particular kind. Even computer paper is fine for this. And you'll also need your tile. Now, I colored one of my sides in. You definitely don't need to do this. I colored mine purple just so it will show up better for our video as you watch me trace it onto this white sheet of paper. I've chosen a Sharpie to do my tracing. And again, for you, I would actually recommend a pencil. I'm using the black Sharpie so that it will show up more for you at home as you're watching this. Now, if we take a look at my tile, do you see where I've taped on these other two shapes? I'm going to pick a corner on this paper. I'm going to try to line that tile up as exactly as I can with one of its edges. I like to fold even part of the shape over the edge just to kind of hold it in place. And this way, it hopefully won't move around too much as I'm tracing it, because my shape has a lot of little edges here and ins and outs. And to hold it in place could be a little tricky. So I want to get around there without moving my tile in the meantime. Just want to get it all the way around like that. I'm going to do little peeks here and there before I lift it away entirely, just to make sure it's all actually on there. And it is. So there's our first one. Now I'm going to turn my tile. I'm going to rotate it around and see where else it fits. I should have more than one option for where this can go. So right here, I can see how this just fits exactly right in there. And I'm going to hold it in place there and trace it. Like following all those same ideas. I'm trying to hold it really still. It should be easier for you at home holding yours down flat wherever you are doing this. So hopefully you'll be able to work flat at a table. Get your shapes traced. So right here, I'm just going to go around and around like that and peek, make sure it connects, and there it is. There's my second one. So it's fun finding the places where your puzzle piece fits back into your artwork. It'll fit, over and over again until you have filled the entire paper. So now I'm going to fill it in. I'm going to speed the video up just a little bit so you don't have to watch me do this in real time. But just watch it how the whole paper gets filled with this one same repeating shape. So I've been tracing my tessellation tile all over my sheet of paper. I'm here at my last one, as you can see right here. And so I'm excited that I've filled my whole page with this shape. And there's my tessellating design. When you're done, you can have some fun coloring in each of your shapes with a different color to make your design really stand out. Or you can be creative and draw a little character onto the tile itself. Do you see how I took my black Sharpie and I just experimented by adding an eyeball and just some funny lines to this to make him look like a little made-up creature? And you could transform each of these shapes into that creature, or you could color them all differently. Really, however creative you are with this is entirely up to you. I hope you had fun making your tessellation with me today. Oh, good. You're still here. Okay, so what I've done is, You know, that character I made just as something extra, completely, only if you want to. What I did was I copied my character into each of the little spaces that he fills or she fills. And you'll see I made one here with this turquoise or teal shape. And I'm just going to have some fun coloring in each of my little creatures with its own different color to complete my tessellation artwork. I hope that you had fun making your tessellation with me today, and at the very end, I'll show you how this turned out. This is how my tessellation looks so far. I've been coloring in all of my spaces with my little creature that I've added. I hope you tried it too on yours. And if you did this activity, please email a photo to me or your art teacher because we really want to see them. Thanks again for making tessellations with me today. Bye.